This is part four in a series. It was initially started to answer several questions from a Muslim brother. Let's continue with some additional considerations. I called the first case conditional forgiveness. There are more scriptures surrounding that. Matthew 6:12, "And forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." We've already read that one, which I used as the foundation of the conditional nature of forgiveness. If I had just read the next verse, you would have heard Jesus' cliff notes. "For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But. If you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive yours." Please take a moment. Well, at least I need a moment. But, if you do not forgive. Oftentimes, forgiveness is not easy. Matthew 11:25. "And when you stand to pray, if you hold anything against another, forgive it, so that your Father in heaven will forgive your trespasses as well." Maybe you've been mistreated or rejected because of something you did not do. Maybe the system has screwed you or falsely imprisoned you. Neither life nor the universe is fair. The list of potential grievances is infinite. Whatever the event, whatever the wrong, forgive. Even if your child was killed in a drive-by shooting. The list of potential grievances is infinite. Unfortunately, that is why grievance politics is ultimately nothing but destructive. The anger, rage, and bitterness can never be satisfied. If you consider yourself Christian, or if you mention and reference Jesus Christ as your example, really try to understand his example. Luke 23:33, "And when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him, and the criminals, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then Jesus said, 'Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do.'" Jesus interceded for those who were crucifying him. This is next level forgiveness. It's very human to do what I call forgive curse someone. To say, "I forgive you," then hope in your heart God gets them in the next life. Somehow I don't think that flows from a heart that is truly forgiven. Now, Scripture does not record Jesus precisely saying, "I forgive you," to the men nailing the spikes through his flesh, to the man who had earlier whipped the flesh off his back. Nor does Scripture record Jesus saying, "I forgive you," to the people mocking him, the soldier giving him vinegar, or those who stripped him naked. But Jesus had to forgive before he could take the action of asking God to also forgive them. Take a deep breath. What I'm about to cover should be very sobering. John 20, verse 19. "It was the first day of the week, and that very evening, while the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them. 'Peace be with you,' he said to them." Here's the context. Jesus had been crucified, killed, buried. The disciples were hiding in fear. This is his first appearance to them as a group after the resurrection. After he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Pretty cool. Jesus is proving he is alive after being killed by crucifixion. Again, Jesus said to them, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so also I am sending you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." First things first, give them the spirit of adoption, whereby they too will cry, "Abba, Father." As the Father has sent me, so also I am sending you. His first instructions and message, I am sending you just like the Father sent me. So here's how we got here. Jesus greets, Jesus announces he is sending them, and Jesus gives them the spirit of adoption. Now take to heart these very next instructions. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you withhold forgiveness from anyone, it is withheld. Father, forgive them. Father, don't forgive them. Jesus delegated this power to them and to you and me. But the other edge to this sword is, but if you do not forgive men their sins, their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive yours. Context, context, context. We must be balanced and harmonize all scriptures as we become mature Christians. Leviticus 11:44, "For I am the Lord your God. Consecrate yourselves, therefore, and be holy, because I am holy." Even in the Old Testament, God commanded them to be holy, because God was holy. This is even cited in the New Testament. 1 Peter 1:16, "For it is written, be holy, because I am holy." Jesus sent out the disciples with certain instructions. Note, this was before the crucifixion. Matthew 10:11, "Whatever town or village you enter, find out who is worthy there and stay at his house until you move on. As you enter the home, greet its occupants. If the home is worthy, let your peace rest on it. But if it is not, let your peace return to you. And if anyone will not welcome you or heed your words, shake the dust off your feet when you leave that home or town. Truly, I tell you, it will be more bearable for Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town." I think the point I'm trying to make is twofold. Forgiveness is as much a power and responsibility as a choice. And it is a serious, ominous responsibility when you think about it. I know I am struggling with it when I see rioters causing destruction. I understand they are angry and out of control like a drowning man. The only answer is God's answer: forgiveness. So easy to say, so humanly impossible to do in our own strength. But this life is not our target, our goal, our hope, or our prize. Our goal is to grow up into Christ's image. Ephesians 4:11, "And it was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for works of ministry and to build up the body of Christ, until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God, as we mature to the full measure of the stature of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed about by the waves and carried around by every wind of teaching and by the clever cunning of men in their deceitful scheming. If you find yourself tossed around by every new teaching and doctrine, you may still have room to grow. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into Christ Himself, who is the head. From Him, the whole body, fitted and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love through the work of each individual part. This video and series is about sins and forgiveness. It feels to me like it's transitioning into maturing as a Christian, which is not altogether unrelated. It really does not matter if you are living in a culture that embraces you or not. The first Christians in Rome were fed to lions. Think about it. The moment you think your life is so unfair and so hard, you are still alive. You have not yet been turned into a cat snack. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Do these things, and your life will spread the gospel. People hunger for the peace that only the gospel can bring. For you, brothers, were called to freedom, but do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh. Rather, serve one another in love. The entire law is fulfilled in a single decree: love your neighbor as yourself. But if you keep on biting and devouring one another, watch out, or you will be consumed by one another. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.